this a piece of UFC history. The King is back, looking to regain his throne.
At all times, follow my instructions. We're gonna have a clean fight. Touch gloves if you wish at this time. Let's do it.
It gets you so nervous.
Kind of like fighting, champ.
Oh man, every single time.
You'll see who's pointing this time.
And here we go. Tonight's fight clock is brought to you by the new movie Snake Eyes. Takedown.
Oh, those are hurting him.
McGregor clinches, lands a knee to the body.
Poirier landed a nasty. Oh, he's got a guillotine here.
I cut no corners. I learned from my mistakes and my success. I put everything into this.
McGregor needs to get up on this guillotine and try to get back to his feet now.
Wherever I can do to win, you know, by any means, that's what I'm doing.
Be like that from the box.
I feel insecurity, you know. He's worried.
His leg, or so we think.
Stop it. He broke his ankle.
So that is it. After 5 minutes, Conor McGregor seemingly breaking his ankle at the end of the round, and Dustin Poirier is going to win this fight and thereby this trilogy by TKO.
Conor, you missed with a punch and stepped back. Tell us what you felt. Tell us what you thought was going on.
Just the thing had separated and my blade landed on the wonky leg like Anderson Silva that time. Something similar to that. It's a fucking mad hell business. Fuck shit.
After his UFC debut way back in 2013, Conor McGregor has gone on to become one of the faces of the fight game, knocking out a 10-year unbeaten Jose Aldo. And then becoming the first ever UFC fighter to secure champ status catapulted him into a new stratosphere of fame, enabling him to secure the biggest ever grossing fight in combat sports history against Floyd Mayweather. However, since losing twice in succession to Dustin Poirier, most recently at UFC 264, Conor has had to deal with a huge wave of criticism from fans, journalists, and UFC experts alike, claiming that his defeat solidified why he is not the same fighter he once was and should no longer be categorized as elite. This video will analyze the reasons that contributed to his demise and predict if his days really are numbered at the top of the fight game. This is Conor McGregor, not the same animal.
And we're down, we go, go.
Conor's a different person too, but I don't think he's the same animal that he was back then.
At the core of any fighter is the reason they fight, their motivation and hunger that drives them to get up every day and put countless hours in at the gym.
My name name is Conor McGregor. I'm a mixed martial artist with the Ultimate Fighting Championship, and I am from Dublin, Ireland.
Ever since his earliest recorded interviews, Conor made his career goals very clear, with this quote being the most famous.
Like Vincent Van Gogh, he dedicated his life to his art and lost his mind in the process. That's happened to me. But and that gold belt is around my waist. And my mother has a big mansion. My girlfriend has a different car for every day of the week. And my kids have everything they ever want. Then it will pay. Then I'm happy I lost my mind.
Fast forward a few years and these goals have now become a reality. He's had the champ status and acquired wealth beyond his wildest dreams.
You ready?
Yeah. Here it is.
At the UFC 257 press conference before his second fight with Poirier, a reporter read the same quote back to him, and it gave for an interesting watch.
I wanted to read you a quote from 2013 that you said. It's really poignant, and I think it deserves to be read out in full, so just bear with me. I've lost my mind on this game, like Vincent Van Gogh, dedicated his life to his art, and he lost his mind in the process. That's happened to me, but fuck it. When that gold belt is around my waist and my mother has a big mansion, my girlfriend has a car for every day of the week, and my kids get everything they ever wanted, then it will pay. Then I'll be happy I lost my mind. Can you just reflect and talk to me about how that makes you feel hearing that in 2021?
It's been some ride. I've got it done and I'm up here. Mad as a brush, you know what I mean? I've been through it all, my friend. You know, I appreciate that, and it's been a wild ride for me. It's not been easy at times, but you know, what a life. And I tell you what, I wouldn't want it to be any other way.
The clip offers an important insight into Conor's approach mentally to his most recent fights. He's visibly emotional, and the reaction is reminiscent of that of a retiring fighter looking back over his career once it's ended. Previously, we would have seen a very different reaction in the lead up to a fight, to never look back and only focusing on the next task at hand, an insecurity that nothing was ever enough.
Again, I won't look past Dennis. I will look through him, exactly where I plan on going, and then carry on. But I believe 2015 will be my year.
I am cold, I am emotionless, I am zen, at peace. Ready for war. One by one, I will get every single one of them until there is no one left, and then I will decide what to do.
There's a part of you that would be disappointed if it's not Jose. I mean, this is a culmination. You want to beat the king, right? The current king.
You're looking at the current king, Ariel. You're interviewing the current king.
It indicates that Conor in this moment was mentally checked out of the sport. The main journey in his eyes was over. Comparing Conor's reactions after two separate losses at different stages in his career, we can clearly see the switch in mentality.
How do you feel about it?
Yeah, Conor McGregor, you're taking everything I work for, mother. I'm gonna fight your.
When he lost to Nate Diaz back in 2016, he was still chasing his dream of earning the biggest money in the sport and getting a shot at the 155-pound belt.
If I go up to that lightweight division, there's no way in hell that I'm vacating my belt. That's not happening. There'll be a belt on one shoulder and a belt on the other shoulder.
When Nate eventually won the fight by submission, this was Conor's post-fight interview.
Can you describe the emotions after a loss like that?
You know, it stings. It stings real bad, but this is the fight business. I've been on the end of many defeats in my life, and I've rose back, so I will not shy away from it. I will not make excuses for it. I will assess it and come back.
He looked solemn, hurt, and disappointed. You could sense his frustration and the hunger to get straight back in the octagon to overturn the result. Contrast this to the reaction of his first Dustin loss at UFC 257, and it's worlds apart.
In the next few months.
Of course, I need activity, guys. Come on. You know, it's you don't get away with being inactive in this business, and that's the way it is. So I'll take me licks and don't Dustin, right? But one and one, good man.
He's obviously upset that he didn't win. but seems almost lost for words and brazenly admits he failed to prepare properly with his inactivity in the sport. This is something he would never have allowed to happen before, and the two reactions speak volumes of where his head was at prior to the bouts.
You're damn right I'm in it to make the money. This is prize fighting. I'm in it to get rich, fast, and then I'm in it to get out.
The only way I give a fuck about is the weight of them checks, and my checks are always super heavyweight, so I don't give a shit.
With money being such a big motivating factor, and his whiskey company now vastly out-earning any potential fights, this begs the question, why is he still fighting?
For me right now, what's important is legacy, leaving my legacy behind, leaving a footprint.
From interviews, he tells us legacy, but this is easier said than done. Only a handful of fighters have reached the top and have continued to strive for this. Two examples that spring to mind are Floyd Mayweather and Khabib Nurmagomedov. They had shown an unprecedented level of discipline and focus on their craft, even after the title belts were won.
It's more like an obsession now. Everything I do is something to do with this, you know? Everything it's always in my head. I'm always thinking about it. I'm definitely obsessed with it.
On the rise to becoming a UFC champion, Conor put his unwavering focus down to a set of mental exercises, with the most important being the singleness of purpose mindset. Success would be the only thing on his mind, and he would use every hour of the day to strategize getting closer to lifting the championship belt.
And that's it, I'm just curious. Curiously fascinated with it, and I can't stop thinking about it. Everything I do in my life is related to this. I don't do nothing else if it's not got to do with fighting. You know what I mean?
But this is no longer the case. He has a whiskey business, clothesline, media brand, pub, and mobile fitness app, not to mention starting a family with long-term girlfriend Dee. This contradicts the exact method of mental focus he prepared for his whole career. As much as he wants to portray it, he can't be solely focused on MMA fights. They are now a much smaller part of his life.
I am blessed that I was able to find my passions, my passion, the fight game, the whiskey game, the fashion game, the fitness game.
Yes.
These are my true passions, and I am going down these avenues that the fight game has opened up for me. I'm going down them at 100 mile an hour.
Overall, the previously mentioned business investments are positive actions that Conor has taken to make him and the future generations of his family financially set for life.
But you know what's also good about, what's also a good thing about money? What's also better than money? More fucking money. So that's it. There's a lot more coming in.
However, with the vast opportunities like these that fame provides, there's also tempting distractions that can derail careers in a matter of moments. The definition of the word notorious reads as famous or well known, typically for some bad quality or deed. And Conor has definitely been in his fair share of controversy away from the cage, other than the tasty comment to sell a fight. In late 2017, there was a noticeable change in his behaviour in the public eye when Conor attended a Bellator event to support his teammate Charlie Ward. He stormed the octagon to celebrate with Ward, even though the fight had not been stopped by the referee, Mark Goddard.
Like that, Charlie Ward! He was cut, he was hurt, and man, he uncorked a shot that dropped Redman. Seconds left to go in the round.
And look who's in to celebrate with him.
Thank
He's still trying to call it. I know he wasn't. The fight's not over. I said, "Is you I'm not going to see it."
Conor McGregor is at it again, and by at it, I mean up to no good.
After his extended break off the back of fighting Khabib, Conor made the headlines for the wrong reasons again. Footage emerged in April 2019 of Conor punching an innocent elderly man in a local Dublin pub for refusing a drink of his whiskey. The assault was investigated by the Irish police and drew huge criticism from fans, prompting Conor to even go on national television to apologise for his actions.
I was in the wrong. I must come here before you and take accountability and take responsibility. And I owe it to the people who trained me in martial arts. That's not the reason why I got into martial arts or studying combat sport. The reason I got into it was to defend against that type of scenario. So to see it, it's like a dagger into my heart as a young martial artist. So,
in his most infamous incident, McGregor travelled 3,000 miles from Dublin to New York in April 2018 to confront rival Khabib Nurmagomedov. He was filmed in a dispute with Conor's training partner Artem Lobov earlier that week.
Artem and Khabib. Yeah. Russian shit going down. Khabib gonna make it happen right here.
The Irishman, accompanied with friends, then attacks the bus with Khabib inside, smashing windows and causing six fights to be cancelled through injuries of innocent fighters.
Mike Chiesa's cut really bad.
Did he throw that?
Dana White called it the most disgusting thing in UFC's history, with Conor arrested and charged in court as a result of the attack.
And Conor saw that video and flew from Ireland with a bunch of fucking gangsters all the way to New York.
Too crazy.
Yeah. There might have been some substances involved.
That behavior reminded me also of me when I was on coke. That's, you know, I've heard rumors. I'm not saying Dustin Conor is on coke. I'm not saying that. I've heard rumors and shit like that. I don't know if they're true and they're none of my fucking business. But that behavior was kind of weird.
And I'm seeing all these people saying, oh, he was coked out. He was clearly coked out. You could see his eyes.
It was just a one-time thing. I'd say, hey, you know what? Maybe he had a bad day, you know? But this is like he jumped in the cage at Bellator. Then he got into that whole brawl in that bar in Ireland. You know, it was recorded. You're throwing all kinds of stools and bottles and whatnot in the bar. And now this.
The notorious one, Conor McGregor.
In the lead up to the bout with Khabib at the UFC 229 conference, he showed more of these bizarre antics. He insulted Khabib's religion, accused his manager of being a terrorist snitch, and referred multiple times to the history of Khabib's troubled land.
Let's fight.
Happy birthday,
like,
Shah in the bus.
I don't drink.
Why don't you drink?
I don't drink.
Why don't you drink?
I never drink.
I'll tell you some booze at parties.
I never drink.
You're mad backwards,
no,
cunt.
No. No,
the Chechens know. The Chechen people know that if the tables were turned and there was an opportunity for his father to stab that man in the back, he would do it in a heartbeat. Shut your mouth, Ali Abdelaziz, mad terrorist.
Ali,
terrorist snitch.
Ali.
I know a lot about you as well, you mad rat.
We all know part of Conor's act is to antagonize his opponent to sell the fight, but this is definitely crossing the line. These are only some of the negative stories Conor had publicized. Photos went viral of him having supposed relationships with other women. He got into a fight with a member of the Irish Mafia and stamped on a fan's phone outside the nightclub. The reasoning for this behaviour is that in the space of only a few years, Conor had gone from an unknown apprentice plumber to one of the most recognised faces in the world, let alone the fight game. This level of fame is bound to affect anyone mentally, and these incidents reflected Conor believing he was near invincible. He had lost all sense of perception and normality, and with yes men surrounding him, he believed he was above the rules, social norms and the law. All these events would take away focus from his fighting career and only happen during his regular breaks from the sport.
Alvarez getting loose, getting better here in this round, though.
Oh, man.
Until that.
Oh, he's done. He's done.
It is all over. History has been made.
After gaining the champ status against Eddie Alvarez, his activity in the sport fell off a cliff. Going into his third bout with Poirier, Conor had only 3 fights in just over 4 years, 2 of those being devastating losses and 1 win over Donald Cerrone, lasting all but 40 seconds. While other fighters, such as Poirier, were honing their craft and working on all facets of their game,
Gaethje nearly out on his feet, Poirier continues to land! Dustin Poirier by knockout!
McGregor was semi-retired, boxing Floyd Mayweather and not really maintaining his growth as a mixed martial arts fighter, therefore wasting the prime years of his fighting career. During his many phases of inactivity from the sport, MMA continued to evolve at a rapid pace, most notably with the recent introduction of the calf kick by fighters.
It's on the sides, so right here on that that band that runs on the side of your leg, and there's so many nerve endings down here and not much muscle to protect it, right? So a couple of those kicks could really mess up the foot. You see a lot of guys get kicked there, and they start rolling their ankle and they can't control their foot.
In the early days, Conor had a very effective fighting style, a unique take on the traditional karate stance, using kicks at range to set up his trademark left-handed punch while the fighter was circling to the right of the cage. When returning to the UFC after his boxing bout with Mayweather, McGregor slightly altered his trademark style. He now opted for a more flat-footed boxing stance, with even more of his weight being fully poised on the front leg. Fans speculated that the reason for this was the ongoing rumors of a potential matchup with boxing legend Manny Pacquiao.
In the time where that low calf kick is coming to prominence, and you know, this is also the time when Conor started moving away from the sport, took time off, fought boxing, you know, then came back and had the fight with Khabib, and then came back and had the fight with Cowboy. The calf kick was never in play in any of his fights, but if you look...
In the UFC 257 matchup, Dustin took full advantage of this. Rather than kicking high on Conor's leg like he did in their first fight, he now kicked low on the calf muscle, landing 18 kicks inside 2 rounds, ultimately buckling Conor's leg to set up the devastating knockout punch.
In like this all the time. He puts a lot of weight on that right leg when he paws in that southpaw stance, and because you fight southpaw a lot as well, it just opens up that kick so big. Yeah. It's such a big weapon.
Conor even tried to check the kicks, but when one's weight is on the front foot, it's extremely difficult to get the angle of the leg turned that quickly to fully check it.
Conor, was the leg something that you felt growing over time as he landed more shots, or did it suddenly happen? Because in the final sequence, there's a moment where it looks like your leg suddenly goes dead and your balance goes.
Yeah, it was an accumulated for sure. I knew when I seen that he had Thiago Alves in the corner, I was like, I knew what was coming.
This bout exposed a glaring weakness in Conor's game that undoubtedly other fighters would look to use in future fights, as he's shown no indication that he can switch away from these southpaw stances. The perfect game plan to beat Conor is now out there for all to see. As mentioned before, Conor had a wide variety of weapons to use in the cage, such as the front kicks to keep his opponent at range and his precise boxing skills to finish the fight. But perhaps his most effective weapon in his armory has been his mind games leading up to the fights. In a sport which comprises martial arts that pride themselves on teaching students to respect others, McGregor is the opposite. His quick wit and supreme confidence was an instant hit with fans, and over the years has given us some of the most iconic UFC quotes of all time.
Congratulations. Thank you very much. Dana, 60 G's, baby!
Time to fight me, it's a celebration. You ring back home, you ring your wife. Baby, we done it. We're rich, baby. Conor McGregor made us rich. Break out the red panties.
He's like a little cholo gangster from the hood. But at the same time, he coaches kids jiu-jitsu on a Sunday morning and goes on bike rides with the elderly. He makes gun signs with the right hand and animal balloons with the left hand.
This guy TKOs people. When I knock people out, they don't fucking move. They're not. Who the fuck is that guy? Who the fuck is that?
This showmanship drew millions of eyes to the sport, simultaneously ramping up the pressure on his opponents each time.
I'm not a guy that douche.
I've never disliked somebody that much that I've ever fought.
The most obvious example was that of UFC legend Jose Aldo. Coming into UFC 194, the featherweight champion had been unbeaten in 10 years. And was a hugely respected figure in the sport.
He briefly does, but Mendez reconnects him and he's free.
Oh, that's it.
On the world press tour of the fight, McGregor tormented him every step of the way.
If this was a different time, I would invade his favela on horseback and kill anyone that was not fit to woo.
Otario, Otario! Otario, Otario!
You know what that means? Pussy.
Okay, Beverly.
What you gonna do?
Can we move the seat?
Rory?
Let's reconfigure the seat.
Little Brazilian. Ooh, vamos, hey.
What you got to say now? Face to face, man to man. What you got to say? What you got to say?
By the time they entered the cage, just as McGregor had predicted, Aldo had months of pent-up frustration towards Conor. Spotted by Joe Rogan on commentary that night.
Of all time.
Conor looks extremely loose, and Aldo looks like he's feeling the pressure of this moment.
Footage from the locker room straight after the fight showed a distraught Aldo, a man who had been mentally broken and let his frustration play straight into Conor's hands. After that fight, he, like so many of McGregor's opponents, would never be the same fighter again. What partly validated this arrogant approach was that he had never been knocked out. However, after Dustin's knockout blow in their second fight, the McGregor aura had been broken. He looked more human and vulnerable than ever. In the lead up to the third fight, there was a clear difference in the energy surrounding the fighters at the press conference. Dustin at times openly mocked McGregor about the knockout.
Not McGregor fast, McGregor sleep.
And any verbal insults he tried to counter with looked weak, desperate, and out of frustration.
Joe Lee's wife! Joe Lee's wife! Joe Lee's wife! You little bitch of a thing.
You used to be a lot better than that, man. The trash talk was a lot better than that.
In the early days, the press would facilitate McGregor's entertainment, making it seem as though the whole world was against the opponent he faced.
For Eddie Alvarez, you've been mentioning that Conor McGregor is not a championship fighter. He only has 2 to 3 rounds. Yet in your professional career, you've only went to the 5th round twice and lost one of them. What the fuck are you talking about? What the fuck are you talking about?
Yeah.
That's the champ!
I love it,
that's
brother. Play last question.
Right,
play last question, brother.
Hey, what's your question?
Yeah, he has no
his
gas.
His
no
question is, why you talking about shit? Yeah. That's his question. Why the fuck you up there talking shit?
Whereas now, along with fans, they were simply not buying into the hype.
You have won exactly one fight since Barack Obama was president.
Put your mouth, I'll go down and smash
over
your nose.
Conor,
over I'll go down and smash your nose.
Dustin was cool, calm, and collected. He knew exactly what it took to beat McGregor and didn't look intimidated at all. With McGregor unable to use mental warfare with the same effectiveness against future opponents, it looks like his fighting skills alone might not be enough to keep him competing at the top.
And it leaves you with one question. Just how good is Conor McGregor?
I can do. I'd probably, if I, sometimes I look in the mirror and get little frights as well looking at myself because I am an absolute animal, a machine. It's not actually the 145-pound division. It's the McGregor division, you know what I mean? Wherever I go, will be ahead of whoever's on the card. It's that simple.
When you can rack up $400 million in revenue for the company in back-to-back events, you can do whatever the fuck you want. I'm living the whatever the fuck I want life.
It's easy to get caught up in the entertainment and showmanship of Conor being a self-proclaimed great, but we have to look back at his career with objectivity and separate fighting talent from the media hype.
Gentlemen from Dublin, Ireland, Conor McGregor!
With his popularity on the rise, the UFC decided to give him an early title shot instead of putting him against a top five fighter first. This preferential treatment meant he evaded potential fights with top-class opponents that could have posed a real threat to derail his momentum for a title challenge. In retrospect, it's opened a wider discussion about the caliber of fighter that Conor has fought throughout his career. His title fight to claim the lightweight belt came against Eddie Alvarez. He was dropped shortly after by the UFC and now fights for the lesser-known ONE Championship promotion. Additionally, the knockout win in Conor's UFC 246 comeback doesn't seem as good on reflection. At 36 years of age and being Donald Cerrone's third loss in a row, he was past his best to say the least.
This is the first time I've talked to you since that fight. And, you know, one of the big questions was like, you know, the Cowboy showing up to the big fight, all that. Like in the locker room when you got to T-Mobile and you're fighting Conor McGregor, did you feel good before the fight started?
No. I didn't. Donald showed up. Cowboy wasn't there. Wrong guy showed up. Couldn't get going. Couldn't get excited. Couldn't get fired up. Didn't want to be there. Biggest fight. All the attention. My time to shine. I didn't want to be there. It was crazy, man. And I don't know why. I don't know how. I don't know how to change that. But it sucks, man. Sometimes I show up there, I'm ready. I'm fired up and I'm ready to go. Sometimes I get there and I'm like, man, I don't even want to be here. So...
However, Conor did claim victories against future champions Max Holloway and Dustin Poirier, but at this point in their careers, they were very young and inexperienced, and not the fighters they have evolved into today. Winning belts in multiple weight classes was undeniably a monumental achievement, but to this day, he has never defended one. Many former fighters such as Georges St. Pierre claim that winning the title is the easy part. Defending the title is where the fighters transition from good to great.
Because when you're the champion, you're the target. Everybody is looking at you. Everybody is studying your game. So everything you do, everybody have seen it before.
So there is definitely strong evidence for the argument that Conor's fighting ability was overrated. There's no doubt that at one stage in his career, Conor McGregor was unstoppable both in and out of the cage. His ability to self-market has seen him reach remarkable financial highs and unrivaled fighting stardom. Quick wit and supreme confidence backed up by unbelievable octagon performances drew millions of eyes to the sport of MMA, propelling it into the mainstream and being the catalyst for what the sport is today. The peak of his career came early, and after the fight with Floyd is where his mentality undeniably changed. What followed was a loss in motivation and focus. The sport carried on evolving and left his fight style behind, whilst at the same time, he eroded fight fans' respect with bizarre antics in the public eye. A devastating knockout on return meant the McGregor aura he once carried into fights disappeared and opponents are no longer afraid. The injury he received in the last fight could be a career ender in his own right. Legendary fighter Anderson Silva suffered the same injury back in 2013 and was sadly never the same again, going on to only win one of his remaining seven fights with the UFC. In my opinion, these points together indicate that we have seen the end of Conor McGregor in the UFC. Even if he made a miraculous recovery and was physically able to return, he doesn't warrant headline fights with title challenges, and I'd seriously question if he has the motivation to take fights to work his way back up to a packed roster. Of course, he could shock us, because if there's one man to take on an unprecedented feat, it would be Conor. But if this is, however, the end of the journey and retirement is near, we as fight fans will sit back, reminisce and say thank you to one of the most important UFC fighters of all time, as it's been one hell of a ride.
I'm just a simple young kid from Crumlin, Dublin, Ireland, and I'm here looking for a fight.
Looking to finish it in.
60 G's, baby!
Don't you say. One by one, I will get every single one of them until there is no one left. The belt is already mine, I feel.
Getting better here in this round, though.
Oh, man.
Until then.
Oh, he's done. He's done. That's the real deal, ladies and gentlemen.
Da-da-da-da-da. It's the motherfucking D-O-double-G. Love yous all, guys. Love the bones yous all. Let's go. Yous won't stop us. Yous won't beat the Irish. Yous won't beat the Mac Man.